But apparently they're scared of widows and orphans coming into the United States of America as part of our tradition of compassion.
So I find it absolutely hypocritical for anyone to say, let us shut our borders to people who are victims of violence, to innocent people who are fleeing a humanitarian crisis. That is un-American.
Turning away orphans, applying a religious test, discriminating against Muslims, slamming the door on every Syrian refugee, that is just not who we are. We are better than that.
All right, and the mainstream media play on that is always, look how calm and rational Democrats are, and look at how crazy and nutty Republicans are. And doesn't this guy know, Greg Gutfeld, he's author of How to Be Right. It's a fascinating portrayal of how typically Republicans respond when they're attacked this way. And one of the first things you say, it's a great book, Greg, and it's very good to have you.
Thank you.
They respond being shrill and with very little humor, very little vim and vigor in response. And that costs them, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think what happens is we have to understand that as conservatives, we have a target on our back that's painted by the media, academia, and government. And our role is to keep that target small while fighting back. And the best way to do that is to do it with humor, by actually using their little weapons against them. So they're always coming at us saying that we lack compassion. That because we have concern for our own country, therefore we hate orphans. Like, that's it. It's not about the fact that there was a terrorist attack. We hate orphans.
They deflect. So
we have to use those weapons against them. So when they talk about the environment, well, I always say, well, you hate birds. You hate birds because your windmills are killing hundreds of thousands of birds every year. What kind of monster are you that you would hate birds? And when you talk about gun control, I say, you know what? That's a gun ceiling. And it's sexist because you're preventing law-abiding women from purchasing guns
to
protect
themselves. I know that, by the way. But in my nerdy way, I like what you said about tax and government spending, that it's not government spending, it's your spending, which kind of frames the debate a little bit differently. But it doesn't happen that way, and they're not good at articulating that way. And I think it gets back to the humor thing. I think what makes you very effective, Greg, in your own way as a writer and a columnist and a pretty powerful media figure now, is that you use humor and you use it effectively. I think there's a point in your book where, although you say you like commentators like Mark Levin, Russell Brand, and his in-your-face kind of humorous persona is effective. You'll acknowledge that.
Yeah,
explain.
I can't stand a single opinion that comes from that disgusting, awful face of Russell Brand. But I admit, at times, he makes me laugh. And he reminds me of people that I know, that I've hung out with at bars. And I think that's important. I think that you have to traffic among pop culture. You have to get out from among your normal group of friends and get to know people and not reject, I guess, the modern element of life and embrace that and have fun with it. And I think that's important rather than always being angry. Every time you're angry, you're buying a left winger another pool. I mean, let's face it. I mean,
but
John,
you know, I think you're right about this. I think that there's a nervousness. I extended it from reading your book from Republicans who go on traditional venues to talk, and obviously the president famous for going on a lot of internet and web shows, some quite bizarre. But taking your book, I'd say Republicans should entertain the same, going on these same venues to get their message across.
Right? And I understand the reluctance. Because we know what we're walking into. If you go on a show with an obvious liberal bent, the laugh lines and the applause
Absolutely.
Lines will be about Fox News. So you have to sit there and kind of endure it. But I always think of Andrew Breitbart. He never said no to anything. He would show up
That's
knowing
true.
That he would be we would have ridicule heaped upon him. So I always think of that if he, you know, I would do what he did, which is always show up and laugh your way through it.
You also talk about how you got to change the way we debate, not only what you said about spending, it's your spending, not government spending, but the minimum wage suddenly has morphed into living wage. So if you're against a living wage, you're against mom and apple pie and, I guess, life.
Yeah. Well, the interesting thing to me is that you cannot have a minimum wage until conservatives build a business. It's not the other way around. So liberal policies are generally a barnacle on conservative principles. Conservative principles create the commerce that then liberals come in and tax. Basically, the left are the mafia in Priuses.
You, real quickly, on Barack Obama, you're one of the few conservatives who didn't and doesn't vilify him. You're just saying he's a very effective campaigner. He's very gifted at what he does. And that essentially they got to get over whatever content they have with the guy or they're angry at the guy and maybe imitate some of the things he does.
Yeah, I reject almost every progressive principle, but I admire his ability to persuade. The left is amazingly good at selling bad ideas, and conservatives have a lot of trouble selling great ideas. He's got great comic timing. He's relaxed, he's confident, and he is able to sell ideas that have failed for decades and perhaps centuries.
Yeah, like you say, he repurposed them. How to Be Right is the book Greg Gutfeld is the author. It's an amazing book. It's very simply laid out, and I'm stealing all the ideas and calling them mine.
Oh,
Greg,
thank you.
Thank you very, very much.